Ah, nice. Got some sound now? Sound? Sound check? Okay, good. So anyways, there's the homework. I'll send that around here. Also want to add here in an announcement that I hope you recall from last time. Last time we met, there was a request that I honored that you guys wanted to do the test today. No, I mean, they wanted to do it Tuesday after the spring break. So so that's the game plan, and that'll give you a little bit more, hopefully, study time. I know a lot of you are doing your math, and I think that's why you wanted to, and other classes, and that's why you wanted that extra time. So the couple announcements I have is, number one, then, Don's going to make the review then on the Sunday at the end of spring break. So put that on your calendar, and come if you can. I think he already worked out the review test, if you guys wanted to pick that up and look at that. What I was going to do, and this is my other big announcement, is what I was going to do is today do a bunch of example problems from chapter 22 in the thermodynamics, and then start our then have the test on Thursday, and then start the optics when we got back from spring break. But because we're doing the test that way, we're going to make a little change. And because a bunch of other things going on in my life, probably the most significant one is my son who broke his braces, and I need to get him into the orthodontist. I had set that up for Thursday morning, and what you didn't know is I had a Dr. Kelly, which I think some of you know Dr. Kelly, but not too many of you, and he's new for us, was going to come in and proctor the test on Thursday. And obviously that changed since you're not having the test. But instead of rearranging the orthodontist thing, because it was a big hassle, I decided to go ahead and let him do the example calculations. So you're going to have a sub on Thursday, and he's going to do the calculations. So I was talking with him last night, and I said, well, these are the, I can't remember, I think there were six ones, and I go, okay, these are the six that I'd like to do. And so instead of me doing those examples today and then starting the optics on Thursday, I'm going to switch that up. And so that's the little subtlety that I'm going to do here. So I'm going to go ahead and start our optics today. We're going to do the introduction to optics today. Then the example calculations Dr. Kelly's going to do for you. So I'm hoping that will go well. I think it will. He took over our 102 class this semester, and the students just love him so far here. So it's been going real well here. So it'll be interesting to kind of see how he does here at this level, see your guys' take, and see how the calculations I'll come out. And anyways, that's why we're going to start optics here. All right, so with all that said, I will begin here with the next unit, which, like all of our units, and fortunately it works this way since I know your main thoughts are still in the area of thermodynamics and making sure you understand that, let's just kind of do the what I'll call the beginning stuff, the easy stuff, the non-threatening stuff before we get into the hard stuff. And that's good, because obviously your thoughts and your focus should be on the harder thermodynamic stuff. So we are going to skip a big section in the book here, and we are going to jump over to part 5 of the book, which is titled Light and Optics. And so just as a quick review and comment, I think you know this, but this class is a little different than our other two physics courses, where here we try to have what we call 4 mini units. As you know, we did the first part, which was mechanical waves. Now we just did 4 chapters on thermodynamics, and so we're coming to an end on that, and you're going to have a test on that, obviously, when you return back from spring break. And now we've got 4 new chapters on optics, and so that will be our third unit for the semester. And it's, again, a big jump. It's chapters 35 through 38. And so we skip that whole section of chapters 23 through 34. And that, for many of you, at least half of you know, that is our electricity and magnetism chapter. That's the one that we do Physics 122. So half of you did that last fall, and the other half of you will do that this coming fall here. And so, like I said, kind of a big jump, at least numerical-wise. And so let's look at chapter 35. As I said, this is the beginning chapter, the one that hopefully you'll see is pretty straightforward. No, not really. I mean, there'll be some reference back to it, but that's why this class does not have the prerequisite of Physics 122. We can talk about optics without really getting too much into the electricity and the magnetism. There's some advantages, and actually I would say even some disadvantages of already having it. And you'll see here at the beginning, we'll refer back to a little bit about electric fields. But for the most part, I will remember that half of you have not had electricity and magnetism, and the other half of you who've had it, I'll remember that you might have forgotten it. And so we'll, where it's relevant, we'll kind of touch base on it a little bit. And chapter 35, you'll see that. There is a comment they make about those past chapters, but really very little. In fact, the title here of chapter 35 is referred to as the nature of light and the laws, and you'll see that there are two of them, of what we're going to refer to as geometric optics. And so we will take our light beams, we will make light rays, we will make them go in lines, there will be angles, there'll be a lot of geometry, and hence the name geometric optics. And I heard you guys talking this as I came in this morning that you're saying, okay, you're ready for a lot of geometry, parallel lines, angles, triangles, all kinds of geometry that's going on. And that's probably the biggest warning I can give you for this chapter. I don't think the laws of geometric optics are real hard. There's only two of them. You probably can race right through these. It's more of the geometry. Students are working along and they say, oh, how do you prove two lines are parallel? Or what do we mean by alternate interior angles? Or what is the sum of all the angles of a triangle again? What was it? Which you guys know, right? 180 degrees, right? So those are the kind of things you're about to see here. And in fact, I think maybe the best place to begin this chapter is to kind of highlight this word right there. What does the author mean here at the beginning when he says, what is the nature of light? Before we even get into the laws of geometric optics. But what he really means like this is that you can think of light as either and both being made of waves and particles. And so let's take this first part here and say, look, if it's a wave, then something is waving. We call this electromagnetism. I'll just call it electromagnetic waves. And so sometimes we will look at light, and that's how we'll treat it. We'll treat it as a wave. Ah, you see it, right? Good. You do now. But other times, we will view it as made out of particles. And when we view them as particles, we will refer to them as a group of photons. And one of my favorite pictures, which you just noticed here, is this little diagram here. I like it because depending on how close you look at this sign, you will see one or the other. It says light is a
particle.
Do you see the word wave?
Yeah.
Do you see the word particle? And if you stand back and look at it from a distance, you usually see the WAV, the wave. And that's what we'll see with our optics and we'll see with our light. When we stand back and we take a macroscopic view, we will treat our light as a wave. But then, as we look a little bit closer, And we take a microscopic view. And for this browser here, if I kind of zoom in, I don't know, does that make it look more like the word particle or more like the word wave? But to me, when I take a closer look at it, it looks more like particle now, and I can see the word particle better than I can see the word wave. But like I said, I think it makes a creative picture, whoever made this thing. It's pretty neat. What's upside down?
It turns it upside down.
You can see it in the beaker there.
In the beaker.
Oh, through the, yeah. Okay, well, good. Well, yeah. And that's exactly where we're going with optics. And our image is upside down, but you're not supposed to look through that yet. That's coming up here. But anyways, this is a nice, I think, beginning part. It kind of sets the stage of what we're going to call a duality. In fact, I often get these questions from students. Well, how should I think about it? Is light a wave or is it a particle? And I think the biggest problem with that is it's both. It's what we call a dual nature. It's what led Einstein, you know, one of his favorite quotes is, we must accept the fact that light is neither a particle or a wave, it's both. It has a dual nature. And so it's a lot like you or like me. I mean, I look at you guys and I see students. But every once in a while, and it happened about a couple months ago, I'm somewhere, this happened to be Trader Joe's, and I'm walking in Trader Joe's, and sure enough, there's one of my students then stocking the room, stocking the groceries. And it's like, that's weird. And it just throws me off a little bit. It's like, wow, you're an employee. I thought you were a student. And it just makes you want to stop and ask, are you a student or are you an employee? And I think that's kind of a dumb question, to be quite honest. It's like trying to put this in a box. You're not just a student. You're not just an employee. You're not just a child. Aren't you all of those? And depending on the experiment, you will see all that. And likewise, the student's probably looking at me with a bunch of kids in tow and looking at it and it's like, I thought you were a teacher. Could you really be a dad too? And why is that little kid kicking you in the shins? And who's that drooling on the ground? You know, and it's just a weird experiment for them. And so it's a different experiment that we're used to. And when I shouldn't say experiment as much as I should say observation. And so the same thing is going to happen here. We are going to do some observations. And in some observations, I will look at you and I will see you guys as students. But other observations, I will look at you and see you as employees. And just like most of the time you look at me and you see me as a teacher, other times you may see me as a father. And it kind of depends on the setting. And that is exactly the same thing I'm trying to say with the light. Let's not try to answer the question. It's a kind of a silly question, I think. I think it's a lack of human understanding to even try to say, is it a particle or is it a wave? Because the answer is yes. It is both. Just like you are both. And depending on the experiment, that will show up. And so we will then run some experiments. We will have pictures that look a lot like, where am I? Little graphics go. This one, if you will. This is a flashlight. Here is the flashlight. Here is the light coming out of the flashlight. How do we want to view the light coming out of that flashlight? This is what we mean by the nature of light. Do we want to have a discussion of the light being made up of particles coming out, which we will now call photons, and that's what these little circles, white things, are supposed to represent. So here comes the photons as they come out. Or do we want to think of them as a wave coming out? And my answer to you is it can be both. Both are going on. And to explain what happens, we may want to explain it in terms of waves, or we may want to explain it in terms of particles. Both are going on. And this is kind of an advanced idea, but you're going to see that for the next four chapters. We're going to come back and we're going to say, well, how can we explain this? And sometimes we will explain it by looking at the particle model and saying these are photons. And other times we will explain it by looking at the waves and say these are waves. So let's take a look at this model here. What if we do view them as waves for a moment? Well, this will take us back to chapter 16. I trust you remember the equation for a wave. It was what? Okay, if it was sinusoidal, I'll go with that. A being the amplitude, sine, and then a kx, and I'll put plus or minus omega t. Does that ring some bells? Because as we're going to see, both in the optics here and when we get into our modern physics, that we've got to come back to what we learned about waves. There was an important reason we learned this at the beginning, because we're going to need it now for our optics. And we're also going to need it for our atomic physics coming up here. Do you remember what k was? Okay, we called it its wave number, angular wave number, and yes, it was equal to 2 pi over lambda. And what was lambda? Yeah, and that's the part I'm getting at. So if you think of these as waves, then they have a wavelength, lambda. What was the omega? Or maybe I should say, what is the omega? Angular frequency. It was equal to 2 pi f. What was f? Yeah, the frequency. And so this was the frequency of the wave. What did we get when we took wavelength times frequency? We got the velocity of the wave, the speed of those waves. So kind of as a re-refresher of what we did when we dealt with waves, this was that equation. So again, as we deal with our optics and we deal with the waves, you're going to be able to answer that question. How can I handle it when I deal with it in terms of waves? And you will. And that's why your author kind of puts this picture here. He says, let's take a look at light as a wave. And what he's trying to say, and I hope this helps, this is a little bit on the small side, but his question is, well, if it is a wave, what is waving? I mean, let's go back to sound waves. What was waving in sound waves? What was moving? What was oscillating? The particles, the atoms in the air. And so as you hear my voice, the molecules went back and forth. We called those sound waves. Now, we could have high frequency sound waves, right? We could have low frequency sound waves. And our ears can tell the difference. How could our ears tell the difference between a high frequency and a low frequency? High frequency was the pitch, exactly. And so we said we had high pitches, we had low pitches, but all those were sound waves, right? And couldn't we have pitches that were so high that our human ears couldn't hear it? And what do we call that? Ultrasonic. And couldn't we have frequencies so low that our ears couldn't hear it? And we called that ultrasonic. The same thing when it comes to optics here. We're going to have light, we're going to have light waves. And what is oscillating is an electric field. Now, as you pointed out, let's not talk too much about the whole electromagnetic field. That is a whole semester we're going to do in the fall, or some of you did in the fall, and the other half of you do this fall. But at least I begin to explain that there is something that is oscillating. And so when we draw this picture, what this is supposed to be is an electric field. And so if I were to make a plot of what is waving, I would be plotting the strength of the electric field. So maybe at this location, I would have an electric field pointing up, and then it would get weaker. Then at this point, I would have an electric field pointing down, maybe get stronger for a while, then weaker. Then it would point up. But what I would have is a changing electric field. So again, something has to oscillate. So like our sound waves, the oscillation was the movement of molecules. When it comes to light waves, it is actually the electric field. It's why I put up here, light is an electromagnetic wave. Could we have frequencies that are high versus low? Yeah, and just like sound waves, light waves have that same general property, that we can have high frequencies and low frequencies. Some of you, based on what you already said this morning, know this fact, but maybe I should ask the rest of you, what is a difference between a high frequency and a low frequency. And so here is what we call the electromagnetic spectrum. Actually, maybe I'll make it a little bit bigger here so you can kind of see what I'm after. But what I'm after here is, just like sound waves, your ears could tell the difference between a high frequency and a low frequency. Can your eyes tell the difference between high frequency and low frequency? Yeah. And this, again, is our first step, our what I'll call the nature of light. If we think of them as waves, your eyes are designed to detect the different frequencies. It gets registered in your brain as color. And so this right here is supposed to be a plot, and they have wavelengths along here. Small wavelength here, long wavelength here. On this plot, they have the opposite frequency. So this is high frequency here, low frequency here. They've kind of drawn a little picture kind of to show the wave. So this is high frequency. This is low frequency, or big wavelength and small wavelength. But this is the part of the electromagnetic spectrum that your eyes can detect. And again, just like sound waves, there is an upper and a lower limit. Now, when it comes to sound waves, we called this, of course, the sonic range. When it comes to light waves, then we're going to call this the visible spectrum. This is the visible part of the electromagnetic spectrum. And when we are at high frequencies over here, your eyes are calling this blue or violet. And when we're at low frequencies, your eyes are calling it red. If we're in the middle, your eyes are calling it a green and a yellow, and so we have the whole rainbow, if you will, the Roy G. Biv. R for red, O for orange, Y for yellow, G for green, B for blue, I for indigo, and V for violet. And so we take this whole range and, for whatever reason, divide it into 7 equal parts and say these are the different colors that span the visible spectrum. And of course, what I want to emphasize here is at this point, I am looking at light as a wave. I am saying that you can detect the different frequencies or the different wavelengths with your eyes. And so when I look around the room and I see colors like orange over here and blue over here and looking for a red, there's a little bit of red right there, there's a good red one. What happens is the light coming to my eyes is at a different frequency or is at a different wavelength. And they're within this range that I can detect. And could you have frequencies that are higher than the violet? Sure, well, what would we call those? Ultraviolet. And could I have frequencies lower than red? Sure. And what would I call those? Infrared. And so just like we had infrasonic, we have infrared. Just like we had ultrasonic, we have ultraviolet. And so there is our range. In fact, let's look some numbers here, and you can see this relationship here. This is the relationship, thank you, between wavelengths and frequency. So what is referred to as the visible spectrum. In fact, let me change pictures because I think your author does a better job of giving you the color spectrum here. Actually, he does it back a chapter. Let me go back a chapter. But he says that this whole electromagnetic spectrum, and he gives some numbers here, here being the frequency, here being the wavelength, and he says this right here, this small little group in here between wavelengths of 700 nanometers and 400 nanometers is this visible part of the spectrum. And so if I put here visible, 400 nanometers to 700 nanometers, where the 700 is the longer wavelength, red, And the shorter wavelength or higher frequency is the blue. And that's what your eyes would detect here. So if I look at, say, red, I could then say the wavelength at the end of the spectrum is 700 nanometers. Couldn't I also then tell you what frequency that is? Is there a connection between wavelength and frequency? Yeah, it's related to the speed. And so I would need to take the speed of light and divide it by its wavelength. What is the speed of light? Ah, good. And so again, this beginning part, one of the things that your author wants to get across here is that the light has a particular speed. So just like our sound waves had a particular speed, so does our light waves. Our light waves are very fast, 3 × 10⁸ meters per second, then, is the speed of light, as I heard somebody rattle off. Now, okay, good point. Maybe I should say this is the speed in a vacuum. Because, as you pointed out, sound waves, the speed depended on temperature, right? Because, of course, what was sound waves? Yeah, sound waves were the moving of the particles, and temperature is the moving of particles. So it kind of made sense that the speed would depend on temperature. Now, light waves will not change their speed based on temperature because they are not made out of little particles bouncing around, but they are made out of an electric field. So when I say speed in a vacuum, this is the speed with no other molecules around. Again, going a little bit back to physics 122 or maybe a little bit to your chemistry, if I have atoms, then those atoms, say, have a nucleus and an electron. That electron is held together with the nucleus by an electric field. And so material is made out of an electric field. Waves are made out of an electric field. So just like sound waves are affected by temperature, light waves should be affected by the material they are in. And so that's why I'm going to say here at the beginning that this is the speed of light with no other molecules around. If the light was traveling through a piece of glass, it would have a different speed. There would be an interaction. And in this case, it's going to slow it down. And so, yes, there is this change to the speed of light, and we'll build up to that. But for right now, let me just say, this is the speed in the vacuum. So applying my first set of mathematics here, I would just take its speed, and again, this would be in the vacuum, so this would be the wavelength and the frequency in a vacuum. But if I divide it by the 700 nanometers, I will get a frequency of, and so I guess I'll just grab my calculator for this, 3 × 10⁸ divided by 700 nanometers, coming up with 4.28 × 10⁴ hertz. I guess I kind of like it as 428 terahertz. And so it's an incredibly high frequency. And so hopefully what I'm getting across to you is light waves are like any other waves. And so I keep bringing up these sound waves that hopefully you'll see there's a connection. And so everything you already learned for waves, let's just apply it now to our light waves. Of course, one thing you're noticing right away, though, is that the speed is much bigger than any speed we saw for sound waves. The wavelength is much smaller than any wavelength we saw for sound waves. And the frequency is much higher than any frequency we saw for sound waves. So this is waves, but you might call these the extreme conditions. Very large speeds. very small wavelengths, very high frequencies, which again is why your author then put it right about this range. There it is, right? 10 to the 14th. That is the rate of the frequencies that your eyes can detect. And again, frequencies lower than that do exist. We call that infrared. Here is our communications, our AM and FM TV, our microwaves, our radio waves, our long waves. And so we as humans make these waves all the time so that we can communicate. But the higher frequencies are the ones that our eyes communicate with. Now, if they get too high in frequency, well, then they're beyond what our eyes can detect. But again, there's other things out there that exist. And our focus won't be on the other parts of the spectrum other than to point out that they are there. If I go to, and I said blue, but I suppose this is the more end of the rainbow, so I should really say violet here. And so I'll say violet. But again, as we look at the violet, we can do the same thing. We could describe violet in terms of its wavelength, which is the 400 nanometers. Or we could describe the violet as its frequency. And again, we would take the speed of light, 3 × 10⁸, divided by the wavelength, which is 400 nanometers. I suppose if I thought about this, I wouldn't have to get out my calculator. I'm a little too lazy usually for that. But 3 ÷ 4 is 1/4. Plus 7 makes 15. And so that is 7.5 × 10⁴. That's 750 terahertz. And of course, this should be higher frequency as we commented than for the red. And so again, there is our range. So violet being up here, red being down here, the other colors being somewhere in between. In fact, I thought it might be nice this first day, since again, your main focus is probably still on the thermodynamics. But as we get into this, maybe we should actually see this. So I go, you know what? Let's take a look at this. We have some bright sunshine out here. Let me open the door here. Let me get some of the sunshine in here and see the real set of colors. I'll grab a little mirror here. And I'll power off the lights and get it as dark as we can with the door still open. But you can see the beam coming through here, which, by the way, what color does this beam look to you? Okay, it's white. You might say it looks a little bit to the yellowish side here. But if I pass it through this prism and project it on the screen there, if I can, get a little closer there. Hopefully you will see the whole visible spectrum. And so this is our Roy G. Biv. The red being the longer wavelength or the lower frequency off to the violet. And so you can get, I don't know if this is helpful, but hopefully a real picture of what's going on. And so this white that is getting registered in your brain is really your brain telling you what? Yeah, you're getting all the frequency. And so we call this white light. We didn't mention it, we did sound, but what is white noise? You ever heard that phrase? White noise? Yeah, the whole range of frequency. And the whole reason it's called white noise is analogy to what we would call white light. Your brain, when it gets all the frequencies, calls it white. So when you get all the frequencies of sound, it just kind of made sense to call it white noise, which sounds a little weird on the surface because you're talking about sound waves and then you're giving it a color, but that's where it comes from. And we do the same thing. We look at what we call pink noise also, which is like pink light. It's, well, I'll leave that alone there. But we can have pink noise, we can have white noise, we can have brown noise, and they're all analogy to what you would see when you looked at the colors here. Now, in fact, another favorite graph of mine also fits into this category really well, is that look at, let me go back to chapter 35 here. Look at this diagram here. This diagram is a plot, if you will, and on this vertical axis, we plot the frequencies of light. And on the horizontal, we plot the frequencies of sound. And so what frequencies can the human eye detect? Well, it's just kind of this small range. And I'll say small, but the next four chapters are all about that small range, optics. What about the audio part? Well, this is about what the human can hear, the 20,000 to the 20,000 hertz. So this little rectangle right there is the part that humans can see and hear. It makes a nice graph because I think it really illustrates how deaf and dumb or blind, I guess I should say, us humans really are. We can, in terms of blindness, we can see very little part of the electromagnetic spectrum. In terms of deaf, we can hear very little of all the sound waves that are out there. And so this is very small section compared to the whole piece of the puzzle out there. And so that's one of the beginning parts that the author wants to get across, and I do too, that there is a whole set of spectrums out there. And that we can, you know, treat the light as a wave. Now, we can also treat the light as particles. And so let's take a look at that for a moment. The truth on that one is we'll probably spend more time later on thinking of them as particles, so your author doesn't spend too much time here at the beginning. But let me kind of clear off the board here where I started to do some math for the wave nature of light, and let's talk about the particle nature of light. When you think of them as particles, you, of course, would draw a picture like they're a bunch of baseballs, if you will, coming forward. And so maybe the picture to say that I had earlier, I kind of had that flashlight. Maybe I'll try to draw a little flashlight here. But you can think of these as particles coming out, just like you could think of them as waves coming out. And if you think of them as particles, then we call these photons. And so we will then say, okay, like a bunch of baseballs, they would be then hitting the wall. And when they hit the wall, they may make a pressure. Sure enough, we'll talk about the pressure that the light puts on the wall when it hits. And that, as a look on some of your faces, might be a little bit of a surprise that you, when you think of them as particles, they will put pressure, just like you're doing in your thermodynamics. When you think of it as a wave, you don't think of how they can put pressure on the wall, but they can. When you think of them in terms of their energy, you would think about their total energy being something like this, where their energy is equal to, I'll call it N here, for number of photons. How many photons do you have? Times, of course, the energy in one photon. As opposed to thinking of them as waves. If you remember our waves, and I guess I didn't mention it when we did our kind of our nature of our waves, but didn't we learn back in our wave chapters that the energy is proportional to the square of the amplitude? So if we were thinking of them as waves, we should say that the energy is related to the strength of the electric field squared, because it is, what is the wave made out of? Electric field. Square it. That would be the energy. So we can think of the energy as being in the little particle times the number of particles, or of course we can think of them as waves. But I'm trying to mention particles here, so I would say n, the number of photons. And in fact, this is kind of nice because the energy in one photon, we will talk a great more detail coming up. Not this chapter, so I probably shouldn't do too much at this point, but it was an idea put together by a guy named Planck in 1900, and so this H is a small number, 6.63 times 10 to the minus 34 joules times second, but it's called Planck's constant for just that reason. He's the one who kind of came up the idea of quantum mechanics here and thinking of light as being quantized, thinking of it as coming in bundles, which Einstein labeled the word photons with it. And so there's Planck's constant. F is still the frequency, which I always find that kind of interesting, because here you've just tried to step away from the model of thinking of them as waves and thinking of them as particles, and then it makes sense that the energy would be how much energy is in one particle times the number of particles. Okay, that makes sense. But then to say the energy in one particle is frequency, you're kind of going back to a wave, which brings up the question, are they particles or are they waves? Which, good, it is both, okay? And so that is kind of nice. It's a, you might say it's 100% of both. And when students ask me that, and I'm sure you guys over the next 4 weeks probably will a number of times, and I'll say, is it a particle or is it a wave? And then I'll look at you and I'll say, are you a student or are you an employee? And I hopefully the answer is you're both, right? And it's just a kind of a foolish question on my part to ask which one you are. The truth is, we can explain your behavior and the observation that we see based up on what is going on at that moment. But the truth is, you're both of those. And so sometimes the student part of you will come out, and sometimes the employee part will come out. But the truth is, you are both at any given moment.
Does it have mass?
Nope, and they don't have mass. So again, a little different than anything we've come across here. They are particles, particles without mass. Yeah, but the massless spring was just us trying to make the math a little bit easier so that we can begin on an elementary level and grow it. These truly have no mass, and yet they do have energy, and yet they do have momentum. So to fully understand these, we really do need to come and look, study Planck's work, and that's what chapter 40 is about. So we got to look at some of Einstein's work in 39 first before this will make more sense in chapter 40. Yeah. Well, exactly. The frequency of the particle can be a little bit harder because now we have to jump over to the wave nature of it. Yeah. And so what we would say is if this photon were to go into your eye and it would come out red to your eye, then it has the energy associated with red, so it has the frequency associated with red. And so, again, we're calling it a particle, but yet we are also falling back on the wave nature of it. I'll say yes to that, but again, I'll say the same thing is it's 100% wave and 100% particle at the same time. So to explain its behavior, I will use whichever model is easiest to explain.
But in a particle model, do you just imagine it as if it was just flying straight?
Yeah. You might want to do this. This is, instead of thinking of it as a long wave, it's probably best then to think of it as a particle, but that particle is really a kind of wave packet. And so what we really have is a short amount of space. And so the wave has been crunched together in a short space. And so it's got both at that particular moment. It's got a size to it. It's not this infinitely long thing like you would think of it as a wave. So it's got size to it. So it is a particle, but at the same time, it has an electric field that oscillates. So it has a frequency. That's probably the best thing I can say at the beginning here. And to be quite honest, this whole first half of the chapter on the nature of light is not an easy one. It's one that the author starts off that is I think a little hard to digest, that it is both at the same time. That's why, like I said, the best thing I've discovered over the years is to use that analogy of it's not one or the other, it's both. You are not just a student or an employee, you are both. And sometimes you will look like a student, and as I look at you right now, I would come to the conclusion, you're a student. I don't see anybody looking like an employee right now. David, I take that back. Hey, David. So, yes, David looks like an employee, but not a student. There you go. Oh, he's saying he's both right now. He says he's learning. Okay. So, so there's a little bit of all that going on here. Well, that's the first half of the chapter. Like I said, the nature of light. How do we want to view our light? And so don't be surprised then as we continue on that sometimes we will describe our optics in terms of waves and other times we will describe it in terms of particles. So let's do this for a moment. Whether we think of them as waves or particles, maybe particles would be a good place to start. What would happen if I took a beam of light and I were to shine it down and hit a mirror? And so I have a picture there. I actually have the real thing right here. I will plug in my little laser box. Maybe I'll turn off the chalkboard lights here. Can you kind of see this beam light going through there, or do I need to turn more lights off? All right, what if I then take a mirror, and so here is a shiny surface, and I place it right there. What do you notice? Yeah, and hopefully what you see in this real picture, as well as what is shown here, as you've got an incident ray coming in, and you got a reflected wave coming out. And if we were to treat these as particles, just like we just have got done in our thermal dynamics, we did this in chapter 21 where we said, look, if this was an atom coming in, this atom coming in would have a velocity in the x direction, right? And a velocity in the y direction, negative y direction. When it made a ricochet, then the y direction, which was down, now becomes up, but the x direction stays the same. And so this thing ricochets. And if we call this the incident angle and this the reflected angle, how are those two angles related? And I'll draw a line perpendicular to the surface, which I'll remind you, what do you call a line perpendicular to a surface? Normal, okay. And actually, I say remind you, but have we used the word normal this semester? Maybe we haven't. All right, so let me go back to your math class. What do you call a line perpendicular to a surface? Yeah, a normal. And we did it a lot in physics 122, but half of you haven't had 122. And we did it a lot in 121 too, and all of you had 121, yes. Yeah, but this semester might be the first time that we've called it a normal, but a line perpendicular to a surface is called a normal. And so your author is calling this theta 1, and he's calling this then theta 1 prime. Now, let me emphasize, he is not meaning this being the derivative. Okay, he means that this is some other angle. And how are those related? How is theta 1 connected to theta 1 prime? Yeah, and I tried to put it in pictures of molecules bouncing off, because if this comes down and bounces off and it still has the same x velocity, but the y velocity has the same magnitude but opposite, then taking the tangent and the tangent is going to be the same number. And so those two angles are equal. And so what we call the first law, the law of reflection, is probably the easiest of the two. It is just to say that the angle coming in, which we're going to call the incident angle, and the angle coming out, which we'll call the reflected angle, they are equal. And so if we do something, such as rotate the mirror, in fact, maybe I'll draw a black line coming in and a black line going out. If I were to rotate the mirror a little bit, and maybe change colors to blue, now the beam is coming in blue and reflecting out blue, and the normal is now here. But can you see the incident angle still equals the reflected angle? And so we still have the law of reflection. And so this is what I was commenting earlier, what you commented earlier. The laws of geometric optics are not hard. There's only two of them, and this is the first one. This is, you know, hey, angle coming in equals angle going out. The only thing that might make it a little more challenging then is when we tie this together with lots of reflections and a little bit of geometry. Look at this next picture here. Your author says, let's take a look at something like this. And he says, okay, let's look at this light beam coming in. And when it hits this first mirror, M1, it's going to reflect off. Here's what you need to know. That angle equals that angle. That is our first law of geometric optics. That is the law of reflection. And so if you took, like in this case, two mirrors, and so they say take a mirror one, take a mirror two, put them together, and they say at 120 degrees, the question might be, what is the direction of the final beam after it hits and bounces off the two mirrors? Well, that means you got a little geometry to do. But if you put together geometry together with the law of reflection, you have the direction. And so look what the author does here. He says, okay, we could actually do this. We could start off by saying, all right, this coming in, which is 65, must equal that angle, which is, of course, to be 65. That's the first big step. So that means, couldn't we get this angle here, delta? Which maybe I'll start writing it on the board. So what would delta be? Yeah, and so working through this problem, delta would be, did you say 25? 25, right? And so there must be delta. That should lead me over here to gamma, shouldn't it? What would gamma be? Okay, good. So if this is 120, and then we add, of course, 25 to it, that's 145. That leaves me with 35 for gamma. And so then I would go through here and say there is gamma, 35. If I continue on and say, all right, then that angle is 35, what would then this angle be, which your author is referring to as the incident angle into the second mirror? How does he label it? Theta M2. So theta M2 is, did I hear 55? And so that adds up to 90. Good. And so you guys can see where I'm going with this, that all I need to do is apply the law of reflections. together with geometry. And in this case, that was meaning that the angle of a triangle add up to 180 degrees, and that a right angle was 90, and this is 90. So could I get that angle, which they call angle theta prime in M2? Yeah, what would that be? Would also be 55 degrees. Okay, and so that would tell me the angle, at least relative to mirror number 2. This picture I like a lot because here the author is jumping down and saying, where would the beam have gone if it had never hit a mirror? Where is it going now that it has hit two mirrors? And so what he calls alpha here is oftentimes will be our question. What is the deviation angle of our beam? Where is this angle, where is this ray going now compared to where it would have gone had we not put our optics there? And so without our what we'll call optical elements in the path, where is it going? So in this case here, we could then start to add things up. And as your author points out here, this angle must be, 90 minus theta 1, because obviously that and that angle are 90, so these and these have to add up to 90. And so we could figure out that angle. Your author then says this too must be gamma, and so I've got two gammas there, but I can then get this triangle and get my alpha. And so what is that alpha? In fact, I'll leave it alone and let you go through the example and do the homework. But I think you're seeing the idea of what we call the first law, the law of reflection. Yeah.
This only works with flat mirrors though, right?
No. It would get harder if the mirror is curved, which we will do, but not till next chapter. But as you'll see in the next chapter, as long as you're asking it, if I had a mirror that was curved and a beam came in, I would have to look at the slope at that point to find out what angle is the mirror at, because another beam that's adjacent to it would be hitting a section of the mirror that has a different slope. And that different slope means it's hitting at a different incident angle, which means it's going to be reflected to a different location. So, yeah, I think you see the idea. And so this is a little more involved discussion, but I will say this. This is very easily explained using the law of reflection. It's just a lot more geometry because the angles keep changing, which is what we will do next in the next chapter. And so you'll see in the next chapter, we won't have any new laws. Our two laws that we're about to talk about will explain the behavior of mirrors and lenses, but it's quite involved. So this chapter just gives us the basic of the laws, and the next chapter applies them to curved mirrors and curved glass surfaces. All right. So again, just taking our first couple of hours here on our first chapter, let's look at what else is happening. Let me show... where did it? Here's our mirror. Thought he had a good picture of both of these. This is the one I'm after. Let's look at this one for a moment. What if I don't hit an actual mirror? Let me clean this up a little bit. I'll take this off and kind of clear this part off for a second and say, instead of actually hitting a mirror, let me just hit a flat glass piece. Like, say that. Now, what do you notice here? Yeah. Do you see the reflection? Okay, so I want to emphasize, that the reflection is still taking place. If I draw a normal, I would have the angle of incident and I will have the angle of reflection. And so that still takes place, whether it be the surface of a glass or of a mirror, and that's this part right here. The light comes in, it bounces off, and so I have a reflected wave. And these two angles are equal. That's our first law, our law of reflection. However, what is different is that not 100% of the light. If you want to think of these as a particle model, you could say some of them reflected off and some of them transmitted into the glass. And this means that some of the energy, some of the light waves are actually in the glass. And I'm hoping that this little experiment, can you kind of see it in there? And so if I draw the beam coming in, and I'll put a little mark here so that when I take the glass piece away, that is the direction. Oh, you know what I should have done an outline of the glass block. So when I take it away, turn the lights back on, you will hopefully see, oh, and I should have drawn that one. But you will hopefully see here that this second ray, the one that goes into the block, the one that we're going to call the refracted beam is the second law. And so this is what we will call refraction. Oh, now maybe I should point out both so I don't confuse you. I'll put it back on here. Notice then, and this is what I mean by the second law, and this is really the whole chapter, and if I want to say my same silly joke, do you want to know all the answers to all the homework problems in this chapter? Well, the first one is the law of reflection, and the second one is coming up here, the law of refraction. And what I'm basically trying to say is we can figure out where the beam is going to go, because the beam is either going to be reflected or refracted. And so the reflected one we've just talked about, that the angle of incidence equals the angle of reflection. But the second ray, I want you to notice, actually turns a little bit. And I want you to notice that the incident angle theta 1 does not equal what we'll call the refracted angle theta 2. And I'm hoping you notice that in my little drawing. Your comment was the light beam coming out. Notice the light beam that comes out also did not go in a straight line. It bent. And again, we would call that refraction. So whether the light is going in or whether the light is coming out, so in this case I have both, my focus is really just on the light going in so we can understand the second law of geometric optics, the law of refraction. But the light going in and the light coming out has a bend to it. In fact, as long as you're talking about the light coming out, is it dark enough for you to see a reflection right there? So there is a piece of the beam going up in the glass. There is a little reflection. If I turn off the overhead, you'll actually see there is a little bit of reflection. So at each surface, we have a reflection and a refraction. So the part going in as well as the part going out. But as long as we understand the part going in, then I think we can also understand the part going out. And so again, what this chapter is about is just, can you understand the law of reflection and the law of refraction? And then if you just have it multiple times, you just have to do a bunch of geometry. And I say that like, oh, big deal, bunch of geometries. But when you get your chance to actually do the homework, you'll see what I mean. It is a bunch of geometry. And so like that one I was just showing you, that's exactly what you'll see, yeah.
Will the light going into the glass and out of the glass be parallel when the surfaces are parallel?
Okay, and maybe that would be worth going through, because that would be a great question to ask. If you caught it, David's question is saying, is this one going in and this one going out, are they parallel? Well, if we know the law of refraction, we can calculate that. And so maybe we'll do that in a minute once we learn the law of refraction. But the answer is yes, if two conditions are met. First condition is these two surfaces have to be parallel. Second condition is what it goes in or from has to go out too. So in other words, I couldn't have like a glass of water here. I have air to glass, and then I have to go glass to air again. But as long as the medium on what it goes in and what it comes out is the same, and as long as those are parallel, then yes, the beam will be parallel. In fact, one of your harder homework questions is this. Let me power the lights down so you can see it. This is where the beam is going now. If I remove the glass, this is where the beam would have gone had I not put the glass block there. So this is where the beam was going when I had the glass block there. This is where it would have gone without the glass block. One of your homework questions is, how far over is that shifted because of the refraction that takes place in that glass of that light in that glass? And so the light has been shifted a little bit. And so if you are an observer over here, this is going to bring up some interesting questions as we get more advanced in the next chapter. We say, where does this person think the light is coming from, and where does the light actually come from? So this person takes the light beam, traces it back, and thinks there's the object. And so if this is a gunnery looking through a thick window on a tank, looking out at the enemy, hopefully they will know the difference between where does the target appear to be and where actually is the target. Because in this case, if you shoot where it appears to be, you just missed your target. And so the optics and the traveling of the light is very important to our optical system, and hopefully the computer on board can calculate that real quick, figure it out, aim the tank, shoot, and you know, hit the target in first shot. But where it is and where it appears to be versus where it actually is what we're going to eventually do with all of this. But again, I'm getting ahead of myself here. I'm just trying to show you the basic physics, what is going on, and then we will use that basic physics to make lens and optical systems and mirrors and all kinds of fun stuff in the next chapter, and how we can magnify things, how we can reduce things, how can we make them look closer, how can we make them look farther, and all those things that we like to do with our optics. But it's all based upon the principles of reflection and refraction. And so, the second law of geometric optics, often referred to as Snell's law, because Snell is the one who figured it out. Let's go through his logic. Maybe I'll take this picture and draw it a little bigger here. Let's look at this. Just to make it a little more usable in terms of geometry, let me take the interface between the glass and the air for a second and take this beam that's coming down, and just to give me something for discussion, let me give a width to my beam. And actually, let me give a little more width to my beam so I can draw some details in here. So here's the beam width. I'll stop right there. So here's the waves coming in. And here's what Snell noticed. What happens right about here? this little edge gets into the glass before that one. And this comes back to your question, does light always travel at the same speed? No. And so now let's take this a step further. What we call the refraction index of our glass. So maybe I'll clear off the board here and show you a table from your book. But your author points out the same question that you asked about sound waves. You said sound waves change their speed based on temperature, and that's true. But light waves change their speed when they enter in some kind of medium that has an electric field, which would be anything that is made out of molecules here. And so we call this then the refraction, or the refraction index, by saying, let's look at the speed. The speed of our light is the speed in a vacuum, the 3 × 10⁸ meters per second that we just mentioned a little while ago, divided by some kind of number n. This is what we are going to recall the refraction index. How much did the light slow down as it interacted with the material? Your author, and I see it didn't go on, shows a really nice table of quite a few different materials where they measured the speed of light. I think it's table 1 here. Yeah. And he says, let's look at some of these values. Maybe I'll start with air. Way down here, what's the value of air? Well, it's not quite 1, but it's pretty close to the number 1. In fact, what would the number 1 mean to us here? What if you put a 1 in this? Yeah, right? The speed of light, C, in a vacuum, which I should point out, this will be our standard symbol for the speed of light, C. Okay. So C, and if I divide it by, of course, 1, I get just the speed of light in a vacuum. So what we would say is, we would say the index of refraction in a vacuum is 1. I don't think the author lists it anywhere there on the table. It's hopefully so obvious. It doesn't need to be listed here. But what he's trying to say then is that as light enters things that have molecules, there's going to be an interaction with that light. It's going to slow the light down. Now, air has really very few molecules. So as you might expect, air would be just a hair more than 1. And so, sure enough, as light enters into the air, so let's say the light is coming from outer space where there's essentially no molecules, it's essentially a vacuum, you would be traveling at 3 × 10⁸. Once you hit the Earth's atmosphere, it would slow down a little bit. Not much. As it travels through the air, it has slowed down. But it would slow a lot more if, what if that same beam of light continues to go through the atmosphere and then hit some water? What does it say here? Yeah, it slows down by quite a bit, 1/3. Which now, granted, the speed is still very, very fast, but it has slowed down. And it kind of makes sense, at least I hope it makes sense, that the speed here is much slower than here. There's just a lot more molecules around. In fact, what if instead of going into water, it went into glass? Well, I'll just pick the kind of the standard crown glass, 1.5. And so if it was going into glass, it would slow down even more than it went into water. And again, hopefully that kind of makes sense. The molecules are packed a little tighter together, and it's not just how tight they're packed together, it's also what kind of molecules they are. But you can see in general that the solid stuff are packed a little bit tighter than the liquid stuff, which are a lot tighter than the gas stuff. And so the low indexes here are the gases, the middle range is our liquids, and our higher ranges are our solids. And so they change their speed as they go from one index to another.
So is ice a little lower than water because there's little air molecules in there?
Where is ice? Probably. That would be my guess. Again, there's a different atomic structure to it, so it's a little more than just how well they're packed together. But for simplicity, I'll say how well they're packed together. So yes, they are packed a little bit tighter in water than in ice, and you can see the index is a little bit higher in water than ice. Okay, but the main point is to say back here, what then would happen to this part of the beam when it hit the glass? This edge is going to slow down. What about this edge?
It's going to stay the same speed.
It still stays the same speed. What happens when you have an object that one side of it, which in this case, if we were traveling with the beam, would be the right side. What happens if the right side goes slower than the left side? It turns, it bends, exactly. And that's my first conceptual idea. We'll get into the numbers here in just a second, but the idea I want to get at here is the reason the light bends is because of the difference in speed. I don't know if any of you have ever paddled a canoe or a kayak, but what happens when you only paddle on, say, the left side of a canoe or a kayak? Yeah, and so if I was heading this way and I go, hey, I think I'll go to the end of the pier here, and I put my kayak in the water and I start paddling only on the left side, which I guess if it's a kayak it's more like this, canoe, but if I'm paddling along and I only paddle on my left, what happens? I turn to the right, don't I? Why? I'm getting more speed on the left. I brought this out to kind of illustrate it. Your author illustrates it with a nice little picture. And again, I don't know if you've ever rolled a barrel, probably not, so I'll show you this. But he's got a barrel that he has rolling on the concrete. And he says, now what's gonna happen when the edge of the barrel hits the grass? Slows down. And so this edge slows down and this one doesn't. So what happens? There is a turning. And in this case, if we're going with the direction of the barrel, there's a turning to the right. And again, that's the fundamental physics that this chapter is about. You could see it this way. Here is a set of wheels. If I put the wheels and I give them a slow push, they go in a straight line. Each wheel is going the same speed. That could even be a fast speed. I could give it a big push. So the actual speed of the wheels is not the issue. What makes it turn? The difference in their speeds. So whether this is going at a slow speed, it goes straight. A fast speed, it goes straight. It's not an issue of how fast or slow the object is going. The issue of whether it turns or not is if there's a difference in speed. And so this one is, speed can be changed by making the circumference of one of the wheels a little bit more than the circumference of the other wheel. And so in this case, making this wheel a little bit thicker or longer in diameter here means that when we make one revolution, doesn't this travel a little farther and therefore maybe a little bit faster? So what do you think will happen now if I push it? Turn which way? To the left. Won't this side be going fast and this side be going slow? And so if I give it a little speed, maybe I didn't get it enough. Could you see it start to turn? Or whether I give it a fast speed. It doesn't matter what the speed is. What matters is the difference in speed. And so again, this is what Snell is going to work out, and what we're going to work out here in a second, is that we have an explanation of why there is this thing called refraction. Refraction is the bending of light. The bending of light is not something that hopefully takes you too much by surprise. It is nothing more than a differential in speed. It's also, you might say, the dangerous part of pulling off the side of the road, if you've ever needed to pull off the side of the road for whatever reason. What happens if you're on cement going down the road and you realize, you know what, maybe it's time to change drivers. I've been driving for 5 hours, I'm getting kind of tired. My friend is with me so we can swap because we're going all the way home for spring break and we've got a 10-hour drive here. All right, so I drive the first hour, 5 hours, you drive the next. And so you're driving down the road and you're going along on the cement and you go, okay, I think I'll pull over into the emergency lane here. And then what happens if you go a little too far? What if these two tires end up in the sand on the side of the road or the dirt or the grass? Yeah, that's going to have more friction on this side, right? It's going to slow this side of the car down. So as soon as you kind of move over and you get those two wheels to the side of the road, what's going to happen? Yeah, and if you're not careful and hanging on to that wheel real tight, naturally what will happen is this side of the car will slow down more. So what's going to happen to the car? It's going to make a quick turn to the right, off the road, and you're going to go into the bushes really quick if you're not careful. Same thing happens if you have a blowout on a flat tire. You're driving along here, and if, again, on the right-hand side, you get a blowout, you're going to get a lot more friction over there. And what's going to want to happen is the car's going to want to turn to the right. And so unless you're holding the wheel and keeping the car in a straight line due to the traction of the tires, you're going to end up doing a lot like this barrel. Accidents, you'll see this a lot. I saw one not too long ago, and it was about the carp area on the 101, and as I was driving by, I mean, it almost looked like the car had gone just almost perpendicular to the road and just ended up in the ditch. And I was like, you know, how could you turn that badly on a straight road? But it does make sense, especially in that area, because it's right there near the beach. It's got lots of sand. And what's going to happen, even if you just slowly sideswipe a car and you get two tires into the sand, that's going to put a lot of drag on that right side. It's going to pull the car around. Then all four tires are going to be in the sand and going that way, almost perpendicular to the road. And that's what I'm trying to illustrate here with the difference in speed. And that's what I'm trying to illustrate here. That's our comment about paddling a kayak or a canoe on one side, is that there will be a turn. And what I'm trying to say is a turn is caused by the difference in speed. And so there's going to be a bending in light. But here's where it gets kind of complicated. How much does it bend? Go back to our picture. How is theta 1 related to theta 2? By the way, there's that question. Here's the beam of light. It bends going in, bends coming out. What is D? But let me leave that for later here. Let's go to this. How is theta 1 related to theta 2? How are these two angles related? And that's our second law of geometric optics. They should be related mathematically. Are they equal? No. If they're equal, there wouldn't be any bending. There is some bending. In this case, which would be bigger, theta 1 or theta 2? Theta 1. Why? Right. We're going into a slower medium. When we go from the air to the glass, as we just pointed out, it's going to go slower in the glass. And so this beam should continue to travel very fast here, but only slow here. And so what ends up happening is that little distance right there is shorter than that distance right there because the speed has changed. And so this is the same amount of time going into the glass as this had to get over there But because the speed is faster, that is going to be longer than that, and we're going to have a turning, what we would say, towards the normal. Because again, if this makes conceptual sense, let me do the reverse. What if instead I had the light in the glass to begin with, and it's going into the air? What would happen to the beam now as the wave fronts come in? Right, and hopefully you'll see then at this point it gets into the air first, and now it's going to go faster. And so the distance traveled in the air is going to be greater than the distance traveled in the glass. And so for that to work, this has to travel here. This would have to travel a greater distance. And so perpendicular to that would look something like, that's not a very good triangle there, but something like that. And so it would be turning away from the normal. And so again, there's a turning going on because the difference in speed. Which way it turns depends on, are we going from a high speed to low speed, so low index to high index, or are we going from a high speed to a low speed to a high speed, a high index to a low index. And so it's very important that we recognize which one we're going through. Also, doesn't the angle of incidence come into play here? Because what if I did this? What if I just had a beam that maybe was in glass to begin with and then into the air? What if the beam had been coming straight down from the top? What would happen there? Yeah, both parts of the beam would get in at the same time. And so the whole beam slows down together. And there's no turning. Again, what causes the turn is that differential in speed. So you can see here that this second law is going to be a bit more complicated. Fortunately, the formula is really not a hard formula. But you're going to see that the formula must depend on the two indices, because the two indices are how the speed changes. But it's also going to depend upon the angle of incidence also, because that angle of incidence really says how much more time does it spend in one versus the other. So let's actually work it out here. And so here was Snell's logic. Here is our second law of geometric optics. Snell says, see this distance right here? Wouldn't this be the velocity in the air multiplied by the time of transition? Wouldn't this distance over here be the velocity in the glass multiplied by the time of transition? If we were to draw, and maybe I'll change colors so it doesn't get too confusing up here, but if we were to draw a vertical line here, the normal, then this right here is what we would call theta 1, right? At what angle does the incident light come in? And notice the incident light is measured from the vertical, from the normal, okay? So there's theta 1. Now, if we look closely at that, that would mean that this right here is also theta 1. Because this is 90 degrees and this one is 90 degrees. So in other words, this is the complement of that one and this one is the complement of that one. And so those must be the same angle, theta 1. The reason I say that is because if I then write the sine of theta 1 and I look at this triangle that's formed, it would be the velocity in the air multiplied by the transition time over the hypotenuse. And I'll put a little right angle here. The hypotenuse would be the overlap of the two surfaces. Because look at the triangle down below. The triangle down below, and maybe a different color might make it stand out here, but if I were to draw a vertical line down here, and it might be better to draw it over here, this would be what I'm looking for. This is theta 2. How is theta 2 related to theta 1? But by the same logic, the complement of theta 2 is this one. The complement of that one is this little angle in there. And I don't have enough room to write it in there, but that would be a theta 2. So sine of theta 2 would be velocity in the glass times the transition time over the hypotenuse. And so now if I do a little bit of arithmetic, I can take this one and write it as sine theta 1 over velocity in air is equal to transition time over hypotenuse. But transition time over hypotenuse is the same as sine theta 2 over the velocity in the glass. And so putting those two together, give me sine theta 1 over velocity in air is equal to sine theta 2 over velocity in glass. I'll keep going with this equation, but I think this equation illustrates what I was saying. How do you figure out what theta 2 is? What does theta 2 depend on? The difference in their speed. And what angle did you come in at? And so that's why this law is a little bit harder than just the law of reflection. The law of reflection was easy. Angle of incidence equals angle of reflection, end of story. But Snell's law here, the second law, we've got a connection between what does it come in at, what is the difference in speed. We can simplify it a little bit, but I'll do that in a second, yeah. It is. If this was a beam, that's exactly what would happen. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's going to change its width. And again, we can go through the geometry and find the new width. That's a good problem. I don't think that's a homework problem. That'd be a good test problem. Thanks. So what's the new size of the beam? Yeah. Yeah. Now, if I go ahead and I make this next step, which is to write sine of theta 1 alone, but then take the velocity in the air. The velocity of the air could be written this way, as the speed of light divided by the index of the air. And this over here, theta 2, can be written as c divided by the index of glass. And of course, what's nice there is both of them have C in it, so they can be crossed out. And this compound fraction even simplifies. So what we get is the index of the air times sine of theta 1 and index of the glass times the sine of theta 2. I'll take one more step just to generalize it. I'll call this N1 sine theta 1. I know in my derivation I called it air, but couldn't have it been any material? Couldn't have been water? It could have been another piece of glass. So let me just call it index 1. And what I mean by that is this material that it starts in is the 1. And so whatever index it starts in times the sine of that angle must equal to the index it goes into times the sine that it goes. And I'll double box it here. And this is what I was after in this long conversation. What is the relationship between those two angles? And so, although there may be a lot of geometry, I can guarantee you this, that every problem you will do will involve either the first law, the law of reflection, or the second law, Snell's law. I mean, let's look at some of the problems you might come across here, which, again, will be after you take the test, which is after the spring break. So it's a little bit down the road there, granted. But if we look at, here's a pretty good problem. This, we may ask ourselves, where is this beam headed? Of course, it's going to hit this surface, and so we can also ask, where is it after it goes through that surface? But you can see here that the light comes in, theta 1, and then refracts here, which would be a theta 2. And then, if I know three of those four, then I can find the other one. And I'm not sure what question this one is asking. It kind of looks like they might be asking what's the index of the material. But what I could do is I could use my geometry here, and I know that these two angles are equal because of the law of reflection. I also know mathematically how these two are connected because of the law of refraction. And so I just need to look at whatever problem is involved and say, okay, let's trace the rays, and between the law of reflection and the law of refraction and a lot of geometry, I should be able to figure out where this beam is going. I think one of the neat examples they have is this one, where they take a glass prism and they send the beam in. So there is the incident angle, right? That right there then would be the refracted angle. As it goes across and it hits the other surface, then this angle would be the angle of incident of that surface, and this would be the angle of refraction of that surface. Now, it looks like this problem, they arranged it so that these two are the same, but that may not have been the case. And you'll see that in a lab we do. You actually are going to do a lab very much like this. You're going to send in light, you're going to send it to the prism, you got to calculate where it comes out, and then you got to measure where it comes out and see if your geometry works out well. And so that's, like I said, one of many, many options. But there's another consequences. I think this is a good one to look at. This one is what I had earlier here in the picture. What if you came straight in? What if theta 1 equals 0? Well, this is the one I was saying, that if you took a surface and the beam came straight in, wouldn't both sides of the beam hit the other medium at the same time? So there'd be no bending, right? And of course, if you look at the math, it makes sense. If theta 1 equals 0, that means this side of the equation equals 0, regardless of the value of the index you have, which the only way that's going to come out to be 0 is if theta 2 is also 0. And so it doesn't come as too much of a surprise, I hope, that straight in means it goes straight through, or regardless of the index. Huh? Well, remember, we're talking about an angle that's got to be between 0 and pi over 2, right? So we can't have pi mathematically you could have it, but that doesn't match, you know, our derivation. So our derivation here has the limit that the angles have to between 0 and pi over 2. So, no, not pie is not going to work. Unless you wanted to call that a reflection, sure. I mean, that's what you get for the reflection piece, right? Well, what I did want to point out, though, is there anything else happening here? Yeah, it depends on the index. It could either be speeding up or slowing down, but if there's a change in index, there would be then a change of speed. And so on one side of the material, which in this picture your author is trying to say is this would be index number one, you would have something that looks like this. You would have the velocity in index number one would be the wavelength in number one times the frequency in number one. Whereas in medium number two, you would now have wavelength number two times frequency number two. Keeping in mind what we said about an hour ago with the particle model, remember the energy is connected to the frequency? Because what I want you to get out of this is the speeds aren't the same. But is there anything the same between medium one and medium two? The frequency. Why would I say the frequency? Conservation of energy, right? This is related to the energy. So, as we go from one medium to another, I can say the frequency in one and the frequency in the other are the same. If I then write the speed as c divided by n1 over lambda 1 and c over n2 over lambda 2, remembering that the c is the same number, I can cancel it off. If I do a little cross multiplying here at first, I'll kind of take an intermediate step. So wavelength number 2 over n1 equals wavelength number 1 over n2. Maybe I'll write it this way as n2 over times lambda 2 and n1 times lambda 1. Then this would be the relationship. And so what I'm getting at is what did change as it went from one medium into another? The wavelength. So not only did the speed change, but also the wavelength change, but the frequency did not. And that's the key here to a number of problems, is to remember that the wavelength will change. For the sake of discussion, let's just say that it... let's just say that it started in a vacuum. So let's say N1 is equal to 1. We often label the wavelength in a vacuum as lambda naught. And so talking about the wavelength really means you need to talk about the wavelength in what medium. And so when we said earlier visible light is, say, violet, which is, say, 400 nanometers. Now I should have been a little more clear. It's 400 nanometers in a vacuum. Because if that same light then travels into something like a piece of glass, or more importantly, into salt water, is it going to be 400? No. And, of course, this calculation would say the wavelength now would be the wavelength in the vacuum divided by the index that it went into. And so even though we call it 400, then we say, oh, your eyes can see 400, it's not really 400 when your eyes pick it up. Your eyes pick it up, it's been reduced by the value of salt water, which is about like a 1.35, if you remember from the chart up there. Don't get me wrong. We still call it 400. We still call it violet. And if that same light had started in the vacuum coming from, say, the sun, it would have been 400 out in outer space. As it hit the atmosphere, it would have shrunk a little bit. As it went through the window coming in, it would have shrunk a lot. As it went from the window into the air, it would have got bigger again. Then as it went from the air into the eyeball, it would have shrunk up a little bit. All the time, its wavelength would have changed by whatever index it was in. But again, just to make things a little clear for us, we would call it a wavelength of 400. But also to make it really clear, what we really mean is it is 400 in a vacuum. Because it wasn't 400 when it hit the retina in my eye. It wasn't 400 when it went through the glass window. It was close to 400 when it was in the air, but it was still less than that. And so that's why we need to be a little careful about describing the wavelength, because what do we really mean? And to make things clear, we often say it's the wavelength in a vacuum, even though when we ultimately see it with our eyes or take a picture, it may not be 400, okay? So be careful there. Oh, let's keep going. Again, this is kind of our basic stuff. You guys are kind of shaking your head like, yeah, this seems pretty straightforward and good. I hope it is. Let's look at this graph. Let's look at a little closer measurement. In fact, you will do a lab in a couple of weeks on what we're going to call dispersion. Where'd it go? Oh, right here. Remember that chart earlier? It said, what is the index of crown glass? Maybe I should go back to it. It was table one. On table one, Table one. Somewhere in here was our crown glass. What did it say the index was? 1.52, right? But if you look a little more careful at it, as we said earlier, isn't the light speed affected by how it interacts? Now, red light is a little different than green light, which is a little different than violet light, right? How is it different? The frequencies, right? Or wavelength, whichever way you want to think about it. And so as the wave goes up and down and it interacts with the molecule, doesn't it interact differently? Doesn't something with a higher frequency going to interact maybe a little bit more than something at a lower frequency? Because even though this table said 1.25, on closer inspection, it gets a little more interesting. Let's look at this crown glass. There is 1.52, right there. What do you really notice about the index here? Well, over here in the reds, the lower frequency, do you notice it's a hair less than 1.52? Oh, what about for frequencies that are high in the violet? What do you notice about the crown glass? It's a little bit more. Now, the reason it changes just a little bit, as I was saying, the higher frequency is going to interact more with those molecules. That interaction is going to slow it down more. So we're going to get a slightly different index for violet than we are for the reds. This is called dispersion. So when we said earlier the index is 1.52, we kind of meant that was what it was in the middle of the spectrum. And that's kind of a rough idea. But when you get down to details, there is a closer examination showing that the index does vary with wavelength. And so this dispersion is the name we use, which simply says that this index of refraction is not quite as simple as we first led on. It's not just one number. It is a whole function that changes. And so the index of refraction does vary slightly with wavelength. So sometimes we will not worry about that slight variation. Other times we will. You actually already watched it a few moments ago. Remember this one? What did you notice? Did the colors bend the same amount? Look at these numbers carefully. Which one has a higher index? The violets or the reds? Doesn't the violet have a higher index in all these materials compared to the red? The higher index means what? Slows down more. The slowing down means it bends more. That's why when I held this up here, if you noticed the white light coming in and it bent, what color was over here compared to over here? Which one bent the most? The violet. And so on this prism, I had violet over here, I had red over here, and I had green right in the middle. Oh, look at this picture here. I think your author does a good picture with this. That's why I wasn't going to hook up my prism. But he says, watch this. And so he has a beam of white light coming in, hitting the prism. The light bends. Did the colors all bend the same amount? No. Which one bent the most? The violet. And it bent the most because the index is a little bit higher. And the index is a little bit higher because the molecules interact with a higher frequency. That is this whole idea of dispersion. They're not quite the same indices. And so there are times where that small difference will be noticeable and important. And so you can see that they all bent, and they almost all bent the same amount. But I think you can also see that the violet did bend more than the red. Albeit not much more, it is a little bit more. Because what would happen then if instead of putting the light through a glass block, what if instead I shine the light through a sphere of water, better known as a raindrop? Yeah, and so as the light comes in, it's going to bend. Does all the color bend the same? No. Which one bends the most? The one with the higher indices, which will be the violet. And so the violet starts to head off in this direction and the red in this direction. Now they bounce off the backside of the light of the water droplet, and then they come out. And again, they are going to bend. Which one bends the most? The violet is going to bend the most. The red the least. And so by the time the light comes out here, isn't the colors spread out a little bit? And so if I were to stand here and have light come in and hit my sphere, and so here is my sphere, here is my raindrop, if you will, I will get some light to hit that raindrop. I'll grab the mirror again. Set it up. Get a little sunlight here in the room. Power down as much as we can to get it dark with the door open, though. And so here's that beam of light. If I go back to the prism up here and show it on the screen there, Now you can see which one bends the most. Yeah, there's the violet. There's my dispersion. If I make the sunlight hit my sphere, so maybe I'll move my sphere down here and over there. I hope it will hit, spread out, and it's not that dark in here. Can you just barely make this out? Can you see it if I get a little closer to it? And so you'll see that I have a spreading out of the colors. And if I were to stand, say, right here and look, I would see red, green, and reds and blues depending on where my eye is and what angle my eye is looking. And of course, I think you recognize this as a rainbow. And so here is a picture from your book. Uh-oh.
Why does that one have red on the edge of it?
Red on the edges?
Yes. So it has a red on one edge and the other edge is red also. Down at the bottom.
Oh, this?
Yeah.
Oh, hang on with that. That's the double rainbow. That's a second reflection. Actually, that's a good question. You weren't supposed to notice that. But let's do what you would call then a rainbow. And the rainbow is explained by this dispersion here. So this person here would look something like this. They would, of course, be raindrops in the sky with sunlight, which doesn't often happen. That's why, of course, rainbows are kind of rare. You got to have water in the sky, but you also have to have sunlight. And so that can happen, but usually those are what you call shower conditions, where you have just a small cloud raining here, but no clouds over here, and maybe the sun is low in the sky, like at sunrise or sunset, so that the sunlight can get in and hit the raindrops. Okay, so assuming we have not the whole sky covered with clouds, we can get a little rain to come in, and that's what was going to happen then. So if we have both the rain and the sunlight, then somebody, and this person, would be standing right about here. They would come in and they would get the reflected light. Now, fortunately, during a raining condition, we have lots of raindrops in the sky, not just one. Because when you have just one, if I were to stand right here, I could see red. But if I stand over here, then I can see blue. If I stand over here, then I can see violet. I can only see one color at a time. But if I were to stand here with lots of raindrops, then this one would come to me with red, and those up there would come to me with green. I guess I got it backwards. Red would be up here, and the violet ones would be down here, and the greens would be right there. And so what I would see, as you can see in this picture here, is that this person, when they look up at this angle, 42 degrees, that is going to be the angle necessary for the violet light to get to them, because the violet light bent the most. But the red bent the least, so it's only at 40 degrees. And so as I stand here, the water that is up at 40 degrees, so it makes an arc, all of that would be shining red light to my eyes. Don't get me wrong, they would be shining blue light also, but the blue light would be hitting in front of me, and so I wouldn't see it. I would only see the red light coming from those raindrops. Then there would also be raindrops that were violet would be coming to my eyes, and there'd be raindrops where green comes to my eyes. Simply put, it's dispersion that results in the rainbow. And so I would need to see it. A common question is, if this is a rainbow, that this person is watching early in the morning, which way are they looking? They're looking west. Because if it's early in the morning, the sun is rising in the east. So the sun has to rise in the east. It has to hit the raindrop. It has to reflect off and come back. So the sun would be at his back as he is looking towards the west. So if you wanted to see a rainbow in the early morning hours, look west. In our case, we see a lot of rainbows that direction, east, because we are storms. And unless you're up early in the morning, we often have the sunset there and we're leaving school and campus after the rains, which I didn't see any rainbows this year, I guess because we didn't have any rains this year. But when the sun is setting and I'm heading on home, I'll often see the rainbows and look like they're, you know, over into the carp area. And so there's our dispersion. Well, let me turn the lights back on. Pardon me? Oh, and your question about the second rainbow? All right. Well, a double rainbow. Do they have a double rainbow picture in here? Here's a picture of a double rainbow. Okay. And as you pointed out, you could just barely make, now with the room lights on, you probably can't see, oh, the sun's actually not even hitting my raindrop anymore, it's hitting me. But there was that second rainbow. And so this is a photograph of the blue on the inside and then the red on the outside. What you saw then was the second rainbow. And so you saw something that, see if this makes any sense. If we go back to our dispersion picture here. There's our rainbow here. We could also have at the same time light that comes in and hits, say, right about here, reflects once, reflects twice, and then comes out. And so it has a double reflection. It still has a spreading of the light, so it still has a dispersion, but it comes out at a bigger angle. And so the second rainbow is going to look at a bigger angle. And because of the second reflection, the colors will be reversed. If you ever look in a mirror, I mean, stand in front of a mirror and lift up your right hand. What does your image do? Your image lifts up their left hand, right? And so the reflection changes the order. And that's what's going to happen here to that second reflection. It's going to be reversed. And so you'll have a double rainbow. Well, that's probably a good place to stop. And there's a little bit more left in the chapter, but we'll do that, I guess, in quite a while. Because next time I see you, you're going to have a sub who's going to go over the example calculations for 22. The next time I see you after that, hopefully nobody will be on crutches, will be after spring break, and we will have a test, and then we will get more into our optics.